This week, Jennifer Lopez enters the mind of a serial killer in The Cell.
Ex-con Christopher Walken is drawn back to a life of crime in The Opportunist.
And Keanu Reeves and Gene Hackman team up to lead the ragtag replacement.
Jennifer Lopez ventures into the unconscious minds of a little boy and a serial killer in The Cell, a thriller that's one of five new movies we'll be reviewing this week. I'm Richard Roeper, columnist of the Chicago Sun-Times.
And I'm Roger Ebert, film critic of the Chicago Sun-Times. The Cell is powerful and suspenseful, brilliant and visionary, a fantasy, a nightmare, a thriller, a speculation on twisted personalities, and an astonishing exercise in visual images. I was surprised by the way this film grabbed my attention and wouldn't let go. It stars Jennifer Lopez as a woman involved in an experimental psychological program. She uses new technology to venture into the mind of a little boy trapped in a coma and then is asked to risk herself in the mind of a serial killer.
Are you sure? I'm sure.
Signal
functioning.
We implanted a touch-sensitive microchip in her hand, so if she wants to stop the session or if it gets too intense, she can give the signal and we abort.
The killer is played by Vincent D'Onofrio. There's a deadline. His next victim will die unless Lopez can discover where he has her hidden. The film uses incredible imagery to suggest the interiors of the mind where childhood memories and bizarre symbols collide in rich and horrifying fantasy. After a summer in which even the best movies were sort of traditional, here's one that shocked me with its impact and originality. It works on so many levels. As a thriller, it has elements similar to The Silence of the Lambs. As a visual fantasy, it was like an operatic nightmare. As science fiction, it played fair with its own rules. As a crime drama, it ticked relentlessly down to its deadline, with FBI agent Vince Vaughn joining Jennifer Lopez on her risky journey into the dangerous subconscious of the killer. This is the first film directed by Tarsem. He uses only one name, and it's an astonishing debut, one of the year's best movies.
It is. It's a masterwork, really. And you mentioned Silence of the Lambs, and the killer is sort of like that. But unlike Silence of the Lambs, they tell us about this serial killer. And it doesn't mean, because we find out that he had some terrible things happen to him in the past, it doesn't excuse his behavior later on, but it is an interesting way of doing it and to go deep into his subconscious. And Jennifer Lopez is really effective
here. Yes, she is. Yeah.
You know, kind of a surprising choice at first, because you think of her as such a modern thing, and this is such a timeless, weird, warped journey, but she's very good. Vince Vaughn is terrific as the FBI agent. No simple answers in this movie, and the journeys you take every time they go into the subconscious mind, and they don't waste a lot of time explaining why it could happen. You have to just go, okay, they've got the technology to do this. Isn't it interesting? And you really do. You journey into the minds of these people, and every time they do it, there are new surprises and new looks, and it doesn't look like any other movie I've ever seen.
I really got into this. And you know, another interesting thing is, in addition to the fact that they have all the technology, and they have all the crime stuff, and they have all the FBI stuff, and that is all dealt with, you care about the people.
Yeah.
That's what's amazing. You even start to care about the killer as you find out more about his childhood.
Yeah.
So that it works on an emotional level instead of only being a technical exercise. This is really a good movie.
They have a story to support the wonderful and interesting and different special effects. Great film. Okay, our next film is Steal This Movie, a slice of the 60s and 70s as seen through the antics of one of the most entertaining, perplexing, and inspiring characters of that era, Abbie Hoffman. He's the spotlight-hungry leader of a ragtag band of radical agitators who specialize in outrageous stunts designed to fight social injustice, most notably the seemingly endless war in Vietnam. Now, the hulking Vincent D'Onofrio, we just talked about him, he's the curious but effective choice here to play the hyperkinetic Hoffman, who leads the yippie charge into the Democratic National Convention in Chicago in 1968.
That's the war in Southeast Asia with that plus-killing needle bomb.
You want to crash?
destroyed our dreams.
Now, Hoffman's critics say he's more of a showman clown than an activist, a charge he refutes in a meeting with a sympathetic lawyer played by Kevin Pollak.
What I saw at the Pentagon was 200,000 kids telling LBJ and his little band of war hustlers to stick it where the sun don't shine. That was pretty damn organized. But what we need in our revolution is joy and love and sex. We need a revolution of artists and poets and wizards.
Don't forget the trolls and dwarfs.
But the government is relentless in its pursuit of Hoffman and company, resulting in the infamous Chicago 7 trial.
Where do you reside?
I live in Woodstock Nation.
Will you tell the court and jury where that is?
It is a nation of alienated young people. We carry it around as a state of mind, much like the Sioux Indians carry around the Sioux Nation with them.
We want a place of residence.
It would all seem too over the top if it didn't really happen, but the reality is that the O.J. Simpson prosecution was an exercise in procedural decorum compared to the Chicago 7 circuit. Feel this movie is a risky proposition because it's depicting events that are still fresh for thousands who fought in the Vietnam War or fought the war at home to end the fighting, but it's true to the spirit of that era. What I especially like about this movie is that Hoffman isn't lionized. His many faults are given as much play as his passion for his version of the truth, justice, and the American way. Steal This Movie is one of my favorite films this year.
Well, you know, at the beginning, I had some doubts because it's very shaky in whether it's a pseudo-documentary or not, and they have various kinds of subtitles and narration to kind of get... And then suddenly, the flow takes over, and you begin to get involved in this guy's life, and you realize he was far from perfect. In fact, he was mentally ill in certain ways, and yet at the same time, he came along in a situation that needed somebody like him, some kind of a showboat.
He was
showboat.
The perfect jester for
yes,
his time, I think, for that era.
And D'Onofrio really gets into the role. By the end of the film, I was really involved in it, and I kind of, you know, I was around during the Chicago 7, and I kind of knew Abbie Hoffman, not as my best friend or anything, but I knew those people, Tom Hayden and Rennie Davis and so forth. And they were heroes that were kind of not born to be heroes. They were just kind of pushed into it, and it was all kind of strange, and the movie kind of captured
it. And it's really interesting to see how the government reacts to these guys. Yeah. At first, you're thinking, oh, he's just paranoid. They can't care this much about these left-wing, you know, kind of clowns who are just court jesters.
Yeah.
But they really did. I mean, the facts bear this out. And as we mentioned, it's a tricky thing to deal with recent history when some of these people are still with us, and they can say, that's not how it happened, but I think they're really true to it here.
You got it. Okay, coming up later in the show, Gene Hackman recruits ex-jock Keanu Reeves, the quarterback, the replacement. Coming up next, Christopher Walken is a retired thief who's back in business in The Opportunist.
My wife, when she found out what I'd done, took the kid and cleared out, so I had the money, but nobody to spend it on. I gave it back. I didn't see my daughter for 8.5 years.
Christopher Walken gives one of his best performances in The Opportunist, the touching story of a reformed thief and lifelong loser. In that scene we just saw, he's talking to Peter MacDonald, an Irishman who claims to be his nephew and has come to America to meet this legendary old safecracker. Walken is now an auto repairman and wants nothing more to do with crime, but one thing leads to another, and soon he's sitting in his living room using a stopwatch to rehearse cracking a safe.
How'd I do? You got four.
Okay, less than half.
Not too bad. Do it again. Set it up.
Cyndi Lauper plays his girlfriend. She's very good here. They have an edgy relationship that doesn't get better when crime comes back into the picture.
I thought we had plans. And I don't want to hear it. Don't go blaming it on me now. You should go.
The visitor from Ireland, meanwhile, starts to like Walken's daughter, played by Vera Farmiga.
You wouldn't like to go out on a date sometime, would you?
You're my father's cousin. It's not a crime.
The Opportunist is unusual as a crime movie because it's not about a heist, not about action, not about chases and getaways, but about personalities. And I love the way the movie doesn't end in success or failure or a trial, but in a moral muddle like a lot of the things in real life. Christopher Walken has been a wonderful actor for a long time, but The Opportunist frees him from the formula roles he's often been trapped in and lets him show real dramatic depth and tenderness.
Well, I don't think so. Christopher Walken is a great actor, and I love watching him. I thought he just kind of just walked through this, for lack of a better term. I was not impressed by what he did in this. And you mentioned the ending. I don't want to give anything away, but it felt like it was just tacked on. I did like the relationship between Walker and Cyndi Lauper, because it was like a middle-aged romance done realistically. He's not a master thief or a safe cracker. He's a dope. He gets so duped into doing this thing, and it's
that's
sort of like
point,
he gets
though.
Led by his
see,
own.
That's the whole
not
point.
The opportunists. They're the dundering idiots. And
you see, the ending doesn't feel tacked on.
It did to me.
It
that's
would
how
feel
it
tacked on if it tried to force an artificial happy or sad or dramatic resolution. But what happens here is that these real people get involved in the situation. Now, the guy who's safe they crack is key to the way the ending turns out. And I think that's very close to life, where oftentimes it doesn't end in some big dramatic reconciliation or a showdown or anything like that. But just these people, you know, they almost screwed up and they didn't quite and they don't really know what they're
he's
doing.
A big screw
and
up.
I
he
like
can't fix
the
his
way
cars,
that,
he can't fix his relationships.
That's all that makes the character
but he
more interesting.
But I don't think that Walken conveyed that effectively, honestly.
I
thought
so.
He was just kind of the same note throughout the movie.
I don't think so. Okay, coming up next, Keanu Reeves and his teammates get a second chance at glory in The Replacements.
Here's a list of people I've been keeping my eye on over the years. They've all played football somewhere, not all of them in the pros, but they all have something unique to bring to the game. I'm going to take those people and try to put together a winning team.
Gene Hackman assembles a motley crew of has-beens and never-made-it types in The Replacements, maybe the first movie to glorify scabs who have crossed the picket line, although in this case the picket line is manned by pampered, overpaid NFL players. Now, Hackman did the grizzled coach thing to perfection in Hoosiers, and he returns to that salty persona here. And Keanu Reeves, who played former college quarterback Johnny Utah in Point Break, is now playing former college quarterback Shane Falco. Here he's in jail with his teammates after a skirmish with the striking pros. That's the second movie this month after Coyote Ugly to use Gloria Gaynor's I Will Survive, but at least this cheerleader audition is something new.
So, Heather, you were in Cats, which is, I can't tell you, so terrific.
Oh, no, you know, Pussycat. You know the club next to the airport?
Oh, yeah. So that style of dancing, that was...
Is that dancing a style?
That's Brooke Langton as the head cheerleader, who, of course, falls for Shane Falco against her better judgment.
What do you do here, John? You go for it, Pat. You have to. But Falco's been shut down by this defense all afternoon. Yeah, but I'll tell you this. All it takes is one big play to get him back in the ballgame. And here goes Falco.
I guess I should point out that Woody Allen did the play-by-play makeout scene 30 years ago, but at least The Replacements is borrowing from some pretty funny movies. In fact, it's basically Major League with shoulder pads and not quite as many laughs. Now, there really was an NFL strike in 1987, and they really did have some games with replacement players, and there's probably a gritty and interesting story to be told about all that, but The Replacements is nothing but a tired comedy with some big-name stars who could do these roles in their sleep.
Well, I agree with you. And you know, there's another funny thing about the movie. They never find the right tone. Whenever Keanu Reeves is on the screen, they have violins because he's so noble as he kind of looks into the middle distance and gives his serious speeches. Then all of the members of his team are like low comedy, including John Favreau is this guy who just turns into a pit bull whenever he sees anything that's red.
Yeah,
and then you have this movie probably devotes more time to the pom-pom girls than any other sports movie in history. It's like every time they don't know what to do, they just cut the sexy women on the sideline.
And who knew that when the players went on a strike that apparently the cheerleaders walked out in sympathy because they had had all this audition. They never explained that. And then Brooke Langton, who plays the head cheerleader, is intelligent. She's got a good look to her, but they put her in the cheerleading costume.
Yeah.
It's just silly. It's just plain silly.
Movie is pretty disposable, kind of a replacement sports movie.
There
our next
go.
Movie is named An Affair of Love. And this is quite simply one of the most absorbing, tantalizing, and intelligent movies I've ever seen about sex. It's not about just what goes on between people's bodies. It's much more about what goes on between their minds. Natalie Bai stars as a woman who places an ad seeking a male partner to help her realize her deepest fantasy. Sergio Lopez responds to the ad, and then what is it that she desires? Well, we never quite find out.
Vous avez déjà réservé une chambre?
Oui.
Mais si je vous plais pas.
C'est trop tard.
What do they do? Well, on screen mostly, they talk, and we listen with growing fascination.
Oui?
Où sommes-nous?
Mais on fait.
Ah oui, mais je veux dire, l'amour normalement.
The movie uses a device of interviews in which the partners reflect on their experience.
Comment vous avez pris contact avec lui?
Par le Minitel.
Par le Minitel?
Oui.
Et vous vous souvenez quelle messagerie?
Non.
Vous n'aviez jamais répondu à une annonce jusque-là?
Jamais.
An Affair of Love begins as a movie about strangers who frankly meet for one purpose only, to share a sexual fantasy that they never reveal. Apparently, they satisfy it quite efficiently. Then they unexpectedly find themselves falling in love, real love, but having objectified their relationship, can they trust those personal feelings? That leads to a bittersweet ending, just like in some much more conventional relationships. But this movie about two touchy, complicated adults makes most Hollywood love stories look like adolescent daydreams.
Too slow for me. Mm. That's my first criticism. Also, I did not like that they didn't give away the secret. And I know you can say, well, it's much more interesting if they never talk about what they actually do behind closed doors. Mm. That bothered me. I don't want to be annoyed by a film. And if they're going to use this interview technique, then these people obviously do want to talk about their relationship. So for them not to give away the secret just made it disappointing for me. So it didn't work for me. I liked parts of it, but the two main characters were interesting-looking people. They had an interesting relationship. But it fell apart for me because it was just...
Okay, well, I like the fact that they didn't give it away because anything would have been a disappointment. I made a list in my mind during the movie of all the possible things they could be doing behind
that
closed
door. Because the movie moved so slowly that you had time to make a list like
that. And I wouldn't have wanted to know. I wouldn't have wanted to know. The important thing is it was important to them. They were able to share mind games, but they weren't able to share heart games. That's what the movie was about.
And I don't like looking through a movie and having that foggy thing where I can't see what they're talking about, and that's what I thought.
Why not? Why not be curious? Why not be challenged instead of having everything laid out for you?
I'm challenged, but then I'm unsatisfied. That was my problem with it. Okay, coming up next, my star-studded video pick of the week is one of last year's most original movies.
Roger Ebert and the Movies Video Pick of the Week is brought to you by Nestle Raisinets. At the movies or at home, Raisinets.
My video pick this week is Magnolia, the three-hour anthology from Paul Thomas Anderson that cemented his status as one of the outstanding writer-directors of his generation. Apparently inspired by Robert Altman's Shortcuts, this daring experiment features an ensemble cast, many of whom appeared in Heart Eight and or Boogie Nights, the first two films from Anderson. The alumni club includes John C. Reilly and his wonderful smash grapefruit face.
You shouldn't be scared of scaring me off or whatever you think that I think and on, you should just say it, whatever it is, and I'll listen to you.
You don't know how stupid I am.
It's okay.
You don't know how crazy I am.
It's okay.
I've got troubles, okay?
I'll take everything at face value. I'll be a good listener to you.
I started this, didn't I?
Whatever it is, just say it. You'll see.
You want to kiss me, Jim?
Yes, I do.
Tom Cruise was nominated for Best Supporting Actor and should have won for his portrayal of a misogynist motivational speaker.
Does mother still work?
No, she's retired.
Are you close?
She's my mother.
Yeah, but she's a woman, too. So, how does she feel about seduce and destroy? I mean, what does she say?
Well, she says, you go get him, honey.
Magnolia also features a lengthy prologue about unexplained phenomena, a scene in which most of the cast sings along with the soundtrack, and the most disgusting storm in recent movie history, and also more than a dozen references to the biblical passage Exodus 8:2, as the numbers 8 and 2 show up throughout the story in various combinations. But don't let all that trickery scare you away. Magnolia is first and foremost an original effort from a budding master, and it's my video pick of the week.
Now let's take another look at the movies we reviewed on this week's show. Two very enthusiastic thumbs up for The Cell, starring Jennifer Lopez. This spectacular psychological thriller is one of the year's best films. It opens next week. Two more thumbs up for Steal This Movie with Vincent D'Onofrio as the yippie wild man Abby Hoffman. Richard thinks it's one of the year's best. It also opens next week. A split decision on The Opportunist. I admired Christopher Walken's bittersweet safecracker, but Richard thought he walked through the role. And two thumbs down for The Replacement, which is to football movies as Strike Breakers are to the first string. Finally, we split on An Affair of Love. I like the mystery of this French sex movie. Richard wanted to go behind those closed doors. So The Cell is really, I think, a contender for one of the best films of the year.
Oh, yeah. If we have many films better than The Cell, it's going to be a great autumn. And yeah. Steel, this movie deserves a chance as well. It's really good.
Remember, you can hear our reviews on ebert-movies.com and read us in print at suntimes.com. Next week, more new movies. Until then, the balcony is closed.